This is Malin, one of the hosts of the podcast Love Zero Waste, and today is the time for Love Zero Waste Weekly, which is super exciting. So Love Zero Waste Weekly, we are waiting for one of our people that will be interviewed today, but I can at least, unless I'm just tangled in my headset, tell you what Love Zero Waste Weekly is. And this is a space that Evelina and I hold for news on zero waste and circular economy topics. It could be reports, it could be articles, it could be exciting people that we are trying to learn from and trying to lift their voices or the outputs or outcomes of their projects in this space. So we're waiting for Justine of Zero Waste Europe to come and join us. I saw that you are here, so I will invite you. I'm waiting for you to come and connect. Hi.
Hello.
So nice to see you, Justine.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see you too.
Could you flip your...
Yes, let me see. That is better.
Yeah, that's a lot better. Wow, wonderful. I'm super happy to have you with us, Justine. So I will just give our listeners a bit of a background of what this is. So this week we have Love Zero Waste Weekly, which is part of a 1 month long collaboration with Zero Waste Europe. And this is actually the grand finale. This is the very last interview that we are making through all these 4 weeks in October, where we have been interviewing so many inspiring people and have been listening to like good trends, inspiring stories, and very like empowering call to actions. So this is like the final run. I'm super exciting about it. So very soon after this is done, we will also start working very fast on be ready to publish like this massive ordinary podcast episode that will contain all the outputs from these interviews that we have been holding in October. So that will be released later in November. So that's a bit of a background. So today we're about to learn more about how disposable plastic products impact our health, and how we can move away from single-use plastics, making mindful choices, because I assume that there's a lot of things that we really don't know. I mean, the knowledge gap of all this seems to be quite wide. So today we have with us Justine, is it Maillot? Yeah? Wonderful. Consumption and production campaigner and also policy coordinator of Rethink Plastic Alliance, at Zero Waste Europe, correct?
Indeed.
Ah, wonderful. So I would like to ask you, Justine, do plastics make us sick?
I think it's not so easy to give a quick answer to that, but I would say plastic definitely have adverse effects on our health. If I take just one example to start with, is that plastic, a lot of chemical additives are used to make plastic. And we know many of those additives are actually hazardous to human health. They can have, for example, impacts on our development, on our reproductive system, on our endocrine system. So definitely the way we produce, use and dispose of plastic at the moment can definitely have adverse effects on our health.
Mm. And thinking of the way plastics affect our health and like the lifespan or life cycle of plastics, what are the impacts within that?
Yeah, so indeed, I mean, plastic is a long value chain. So maybe if we try to go through the chain. So to start with, plastic is mainly coming from oil and gas. So if we think about the extraction of oil and gas, there's already a lot of chemicals that are released from those processes. So oil extraction, but also gas fracking extraction, for example, uses a lot of chemicals. So it causes a lot of respiratory problems in the communities around those extraction sites. And recently, looking at the impacts of the pandemics, for example, in the US, it was very clear that the pandemic has had much more effect life cost in a way in those areas where there's a lot of extraction, because those people already have respiratory issues, etc. And when the pandemic hits, obviously they're even more vulnerable. So that's the first phase. And then basically the oil and gas is transformed into plastic products, so into resins. And that's also where a lot of additives are added to the products to make them more flexible, those kind of things. And there also, again, there's a lot of chemicals that are produced. And so it will also impact the people that work in those factories, but also the communities around, because usually it will go in the air around, etc. When we think about then how, when we use our plastic in our everyday lives, so that's basically everybody, our packaging, for example, food packaging, there's an issue that we call the migration of chemicals, basically from the packaging to the food. And then we eat the food. So that means at the end of the day, the chemicals may end up in our bodies. And as I said, we know that many of those additives actually are dangerous for human health. And there's a big question that is growing, I would say, is also the question of microplastics. So there's more and more studies that that shows that we ingest and inhale much more microplastic than we may have thought about. Also because plastic degrades actually quite quickly into microplastics. So that's also another kind of source of exposure, and that probably could have impact on our health. And then when we're done with using the plastic, and because most of the packaging is just meant to be single use, it will go very quickly to the bin, and most of this packaging is not even meant to be recycled, so it'll go to incineration in many countries. And there again, we know that incineration releases a lot of toxic metals and other dioxins, etc., that will go into the air, in the area, and then into the soils, etc. So overall, definitely polluting the whole environment around us. And obviously, when we also pollute our environment, it's indirectly also affecting our health. So, and then maybe a final word would be to say that indeed, if at the end of life, the plastic, or at one point in its life, the plastic also hits the environment, there again, it will obviously pollute the soils, the water, the ocean, and then indirectly our health as well, because then the chemicals may accumulate. For example, we may all have seen this this picture of a fish that has basically his plastic bag inside him, and then we may consume the fish. So it kind of goes back to us as well. So it's definitely quite a long chain, and there's a lot to be done to reduce the impact of on human health all along the chain, for sure.
Oh, and the chain seems to be so like super, super long. Do you feel that we are like focusing on one part of the chain only, or like how much of the understanding do we have for the full chain?
Yeah, I mean, overall, I would say the chain is quite opaque. So we know how it goes, more or less. But then if we look at, for example, the chemicals and plastics, it's very hard to trace what actually is in plastic products in terms of chemicals content. We know very little. We know very little where it really comes from, which feedstock, then what was added to it, etc. So I think in terms of what the public may know already is a little bit around chemicals in products, so more that, and maybe a little bit the things are growing, or the attention is going around microplastic, but I don't think people are necessarily wondering about the health impacts of the oil extraction, for example, because they may not live in a country that has oil extraction. And we may also not think about, when the plastic we actually don't recycle, we'll send it away, ship it away to Asia, and it may end up there. And there again, it's going to degrade and have also impacts on communities. And as Europeans, we may not think about that because it's also not in our everyday lives. And I think people know still very little about really the impact on health of incineration, for example. So there's definitely a lot more to be done to first know more about the health impacts all along the value chain, but then also communicate that to the consumer so they can also at least make informed choices, I would say.
Mm. Do you then see like, is it the distance from like where you are consuming it the most? Is so far away from the incineration or like the recycling, like the concrete process actions that usually is more like local impact, like directly local impact.
I think you're right. It definitely plays a role. We tend to forget. And I think, you know, to a certain extent, also people would put, for example, their PP bottle in the recycling bin and consider, well, okay, my job is done. And to a certain extent, you know, that's great that they are very much doing that. And then we tend to forget what's happening after that. And even with recycling, questions are arising, because if you have hazardous content in the waste you're recycling, then it can definitely have an impact on the people that manage the waste, on the health. But then that means you may actually recycle that in a new product, which still will have a lot of chemical in, and you keep like the vicious circle a little bit. So the distance doesn't help, even though I feel really that on the plastic issue, more and more information and the dots have been connected a little bit. And I think maybe a few years ago, people were not necessarily associating a packaging or a plastic product with oil to start with, for example. And I don't think everybody does those days, but the link is definitely, much more there. So it's definitely growing, but I think the chain is so complex and so diverse all across the world that sometimes, yeah, we don't, if it doesn't impact our community directly, we may not, you know, directly think about it.
So what do you then see that we need to do to change this, or to be mindful, make better choices?
I think there's a lot that can be done, but there's also a limit of what we can do, I think, at individual level. So I think what we can do maybe as individual level is ask our favorite brands or the companies that actually produce the materials to really phase out and remove all the hazardous chemicals from their products, so that we're not exposed then to those chemicals when we use their products, but also to switch to other alternatives. So obviously, because what we realize is, a lot of the single use packaging, so plastic, but also paper, for example, contains a lot, of chemicals. While other packaging, that tend to be more reusable, for example, stainless steel or glass, they're considered to be more inert material, so more stable. So there's less chance that chemicals would migrate from the material to the food, for example, to what they contain. So we can see there's double benefits in a way, both for the environment and for health, to look at solutions that are both reusable and toxic-free. And some materials are usually more stable from their chemical composition. So yeah, stainless steel, glass, ceramic, for example. So I have this joke with colleagues that, you know, you should never put a plastic container, even if it's actually reusable or meant to be reusable, in the microwave, because then with the heat, etc. So there's those little things we can do, but mainly we can really add the people that have the power to change things properly. So the brands, the companies that design their products, and then also the decision makers, like our local or national and also the European decision makers, to really adopt legislation that makes sure that everything that is available to the consumer is actually safe, because it shouldn't really be to the consumers to have to pick what is safe or not safe from the shelves. Everything should be safe on there. And there's a lot of things happening, to try to reduce, or phase out the most hazardous chemical, in products. So last week or 2 weeks ago, the European Commission released a chemical strategy for sustainability. So it's kind of a strategy to really reduce our exposure to chemicals and to achieve zero pollution. And there's a number of good commitments around reducing the chemicals in food packaging, for example. So now it requires proper good measures, and we'll follow that closely. And a lot is also done or on microplastic, which is clearly an increased concern for everyone. So Europe is at the moment looking at restricting or prohibiting the fact of adding microplastic in certain products, that can be cosmetics, but also paints, detergents, etc. So you couldn't add voluntarily microplastic. And then they're also looking at how to tackle all the sources of microplastics. So from the degradation of macroplastic, of plastic products, but also from our clothes, microplastic fibers for polyester clothes, etc. So there's definitely a lot to be done. And then there's still a lot to be done looking at the extraction sites as well, and that may also have to be dealt at the level there rather than the consumption level, but much more to be done.
Yeah, really a lot to be done. But looking into the future and from the trends or the signals that you have been seeing from your work, do you see that there's any kind of sign that we're going towards somewhere? And what does that look like?
Indeed, the picture at the moment is not pretty good, but there's definitely movement. I think there's been more research on, for example, the impacts of microplastic in the last 2 years than ever. So there's more and more research. I think we also see the public more interested on the topic and asking for more elements on, they want to know what is in the product they consume. So definitely that puts pressure on the industry, on the decision makers. And I think there's an opportunity in the coming months, in the coming years, at least in Europe, to really push for new legislation. And so one of the role of Zero Waste Europe also is to bring this awareness and also trying to bring the messages from all across Europe, because we're a network organization, to also the EU decision makers that have the power to adopt those legislation. And to do that, we have a number of campaigns, and I want to mention just one. And soon we hope to be releasing the results in a couple of weeks. In beginning of December, we tested the presence of a number of chemicals that we find in plastic packaging in urine samples of quite a lot of people across Europe. And we had the chance to have as participants quite influential people across Europe, including decision makers. So we really hope that with this project that is called Plastic in the Spotlight, we will also be able to bring this awareness even higher, because it will concern them directly. So that's the kind of project we try to put in place, so that we really ring the alarm bell and bring it to the attention of the people that have the power to change it.
Wow. Yeah, that's so exciting. I can't wait to get my hands on that report.
We'll be very happy to share.
Wonderful. Do you see from the work that you have been doing, do you see what we as individuals, even though we were talking about the responsibility and we need to lift it up towards decision makers, policy makers and corporates, to have legal frameworks. But what can we do to go into that direction rather than just carrying all the burden ourselves?
I think indeed there's a lot. I mean, at an individual level, there's a lot you can do in terms of, picking the most responsible choice you can do or what is available to you. And then in terms of alerting your government and your companies, if that's also what you're asking, I think, the petition role can have a lot of places. And also, for example, the member of the European Parliament in Brussels, they actually come from all across Europe. So, and they may come from your region, in your country, in Europe, for example. So you could also go to them directly, because there's this direct link and local link, and ask them to actually do something about this big issue, because you care. And also, I think the consumer has a lot of power due to its kind of buying power. By just trying to make the better choice that is available. And again, it's with a lot of uncertainties, or sometimes we just don't know what's in the product. So it's hard to know what the better choice is. But by doing that, it's clearly giving a strong signal to the market. And I think we've seen it also on plastic more generally. The fact that, big companies now are starting to look into reusable packaging, for example, into integrating more recycled content in their products, it's because they see that consumer want to go more and more into those initiatives that reduce waste, that are toxic free as well, etc. So I think, consumers shouldn't underestimate the power they have, just with their kind of buying power and the choices they make in which shop they go, and whether they will, rather support a local shop that is zero waste rather than a big brand that is all over packaged, for example.
Wonderful. So keep that in mind, people, and to all of our listeners, go find your your contact person for the EU Parliament or the Commission, and to use the people power towards just accelerating this change that we need to do. Thank you so much, Justine. That was a beautiful wrap up. I'm so happy to have been talking with you. Stay tuned to all of our listeners for the big episode that will be launched later in November. Thank you so much and enjoy
Thank
your
you.
Friday.
Have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.